Hello, friends. This is Dave Hurwitz, executive editor at ClassicsToday.com, here with the Haydn Symphony Crusade, number 40. 10, 20, 30, 40. That's a lot of symphonies. We're really moving up there. Now, in symphony number 39, we began to finally encounter the Sturm und Drang period, the period of storm and stress, with exciting frenetic symphonies, with movements in minor keys and all kinds of extra emotional tension. Well, number 40 is just the opposite of that, because number 40 was actually written, to the extent we know, probably 4 or 5 years earlier than the onset of the Sturm und Drang symphonies. And as a result, it's in a rather different idiom. This is not to say that it's any less Haydn-esque than the Sturm und Drang symphonies are. In fact, it's just as Haydn-esque. You've got that fabulously effective use of pauses, in this case, in the first two movements. They're not used structurally, as Haydn was later to figure out how to do, but they're there, and they're witty, and they're marvelous, and you'll hear them. I don't need to point out where they are. The actual point of symphony number 40 is completely different from that of the Sturm und Drang symphonies. The last movement of this symphony, and one of the things that makes it so unbelievably marvelous, is that it's a fugue. Now, a fugue is simply a texture, a contrapuntal texture in some fixed number of voices or lines of music. And what happens is you take a tune and one voice plays it, then the next one, then the next one, then the next one, and they all chase each other through the orchestra or the whatever ensemble you have, the quartet or the piano, the keyboard, the organ, the whatever. They all chase each other, these little tunes. And then so when they're done chasing, there's like an episode based on other material usually. And then they do it again. And then there's like another little episode. And then they may do it again. And they all pile up at the end and everyone's happy. That's a fugue. I mean, it's a lot simpler in concept than some people would have you believe. But of course, the realization is infinitely varied and interesting, and Haydn's is no exception. But what makes this particular fugue so interesting is the way that it emerges naturally from the prior three movements, not necessarily sharing themes, although it does share a motive. It's just that the symphony is heading in that direction and only gets there when it arrives at the finale. And that's one of the things that makes this such a wonderful piece and makes Haydn's symphonies different from those of all of his colleagues. They're really conceived as unified entities. And so in order to really get a grip on how this fugue pops up at the end, we need to listen to the whole symphony. It's about 15 minutes long, but if I play most of it for you without repeats, we can sort of chop it down. And I don't need to talk a lot about it, because what I want you to do when you listen is focus on top and bottom. That's what matters in this symphony. You don't have to worry about sonata form particularly, although we will talk about it a little. You don't have to worry about, like development sections and the evolution of the themes, because the evolution is happening across the whole work. And it really is easier and I think more enjoyable and more fascinating by far to take it in on that basis. So think top and bottom. Think two-part counterpoint. There's a melody and there's a bottom part. And the bottom part has a motive. And that motive is a simple descending scale. It's just ya-da-da-da-da or something like that. I mean, it can go in different ways, but it's basically just a descending scale type figure. And that is the motive that binds together the whole symphony. It occurs in every single movement in one way or another, and always, invariably, as part of this two-part contrapuntal texture. So Haydn is going to jam home this concept of two-part counterpoint. And not only does that particular descending scale motive of 5 or 6 or 7 notes, however many it is, scale can have as many notes as you put in it. It's like a stairway. You could have one with 4 steps and one with 5 steps and one with 6 steps. It's still a stairway. So a scale could be ya-da-da-dum, ya-da-da-da-dum, ya-da-da-da-da-da-da-dum. I mean, you just keep going forever, but it's the same thing. It's a downward scale. And that's what Haydn is dealing with here. He also uses it in a very, very interesting way. Because as you know, these symphonies, since you've listened to 40 of them by now, all have repeated sections, large sectional repeats. And for example, the first movement, the exposition, the big first section will be repeated. And the development will be repeated, you know, and recapitulation as the second part of the movement. And that will happen in the slow movement. And there will be repeats in the minuet as well, the third movement. Now, these repeats, these sections, these big sections can come to a full stop and you just go back, you know, dun, dun, ba-dum, back to the beginning or back to wherever you're going or move on into the next section. Or the composer can add a link, a little linky-dinky, linky thingy. And in this case, the linky thingy in all of these movements, well, really the first and the third, which is where you hear it most often, is our descending scale motive. It's back to the beginning. And Haydn does it. He does it to join He does it for the repeat of the exposition in the first movement. He does it leading into the development section. He does it in the minuet all over the place. It's in the trio section, which we're not going to hear. It's in the main body of the minuet. You hear it all the time. So this descending scale, which you hear in counterpoint to the symphony's main ideas, and is a transitional object between the major sections, is really pounded into your skull so that when we get to the finale, to that final fugue, it's just there. You listen to it and you realize, oh my goodness, it couldn't end any other way. It's familiar on the one hand, but the subject of the fugue is brand new. The thematic material is mostly brand new, but it sounds so inevitable. Oh my goodness. So let's just start listening, shall we? I want you to hear the whole first movement without repeats. Listen to a couple of things. Underneath that main melody, listen to the descending scales that you hear right at the start. There are like two of them. They keep coming back. And then the whole exposition is just working with these motives. You don't have to worry about first subjects and second subjects and, you know, any of that normal sonata stuff. There will be a wonderful little pause toward the end of the exposition, which tells you that it's coming. And then the development section, which is almost entirely in a minor key. It's almost an independent episode, and it's based on our descending scale. That's how it starts. So listen for those things, and I'm going to play you the whole first movement with the Cologne Chamber Orchestra under Helmut Müller-Bruhl on Naxos. Here we go. On your mark. Get set. Listen. Courtly music, isn't it? It's gracious music. But what makes it so much fun, as always with Haydn, is that its graciousness conceals a lot of little tricks, like the pause, like these strange rhythms, things that keep it slightly off kilter so that you never tire of listening to it. And that minor key development section, which is far more tense than you would think. Did you hear the connection? Did you hear those little descending scales joining the sections? Well, I've made you a separate joining section little like sample, so you can hear it in the first movement, the end of the exposition going into the development, and also a little bit in the minuet, so you can hear it there as well, between the return of the A section, the big section of the minuet, which is in two halves, and they're joined by that descending scale thing, which is also part of the thematic substance of the minuet. Let me just shut up and play you this little tiny couple seconds of sound, so you'll hear what I mean. You see, that's all it is, just da-da-da-da-da, and back to something, or on to something. That's all you need to hear, because that is the principal idea of the whole symphony. Now, the slow movement is fascinating. It's one of Haydn's quick slow movements. It's marked Andante o piuttosto Allegretto, which is, you know, Andante, but more like Allegretto. In other words, it's quick. It's actually faster than the minuet. So the symphony has no real slow movement. The most famous example of that in the symphony, of course, is Beethoven's Seventh, which has the Allegretto slow movement, which really isn't all that slow. And neither is this. This is actually pretty perky. And it's all charm. It's all just charm and grace. And it's almost unruffled. But you will notice that it has two things that we heard in the first movement. It has a sudden pause for some reason. And then a development section, which is entirely in minor keys. In other words, it follows the same shape of the first movement, only with completely different themes, and it's scored for strings only, as was typical of Haydn at this period. You know, the whole symphony has two horns and two oboes and a bassoon in the bottom, and of course a harpsichord, which he didn't write and didn't necessarily expect, but which most performances put in there. I kind of like the harpsichord actually in this movement, because the movement itself has a kind of, you know, Rococo charm to it that sounds, almost a little bit more, I don't know, periody somehow, almost as though it's modern music pretending to be earlier music when you have a harpsichord in it. It's really kind of interesting. So listen to this movement too, and pay attention to the minor key development, the pause, the charm, the delicious little melody, but most of all, the two parts, top and bottom. The whole movement is violins on top, violas, basses and cellos on the bottom. And they have two independent parts, and the lower part starts with that same descending scale motif. Da 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 da. It's in doubled notes in this case, but it's the same thing. Listen for those descending scales. Here you go. Thank you. It's just delicious. Delicious. Now, the minuet is like the first movement. The whole symphony is very courtly, very gracious, and it's a slowish minuet, but it's very tricky in terms of its phrase rhythms. It will throw you off. If you ever tried to dance this, you would wind up on the floor with your legs all twisted up in a knot. It's really fun to listen to for that reason. If you don't believe me, it starts da-da-da-da-da, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. If you want to do that, count 1, 2, 3 while it's playing and see how lost you get through the whole thing. And listen also, right at the start, you hear the minuet, da-da-da-da-da, yum, bum, bum, and underneath it's ya-da-da-da-dum, ya-da-da-da-dum. That's the motive. And Haydn actually starts to emphasize it even more in this minuet because he's going to really let you have it when we get to the finale. In fabulous two-part counterpoint. Oh, so much counterpoint. You're just going to just die. It's got so much fabulous counterpoint. So this is just the main section of the minuet. That's all you need to hear to get your sense of it, because I want you to hear the two-part writing, the top and the bottom, as we've heard with all of these movements, top and bottom. Here you go. So having prepared us with all of this top and bottomosity, this wonderful, you know, exploration of the joys of two-part counterpoint, we get the fugue. And what makes this so wonderful is it's really more than two-part counterpoint. You've got the fugue subject, which is ya ba da 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 da. I mean, something like that. It's very simple. And underneath that, you have the doing its other contrapuntal thing. And so you have the apotheosis of counterpoint in this movement, because you've got this fugue thing happening on top, and you still have that characteristic counterpoint in descending, and in this case, sometimes ascending scales underneath the fugue. So you've got like double counterpoint. You got a fugue thing on top and a counterpoint thing on the bottom. It's just a fiesta of writing in multiple voices. And it's just fabulous. And one of the things I do want you to keep in mind, and we talked about this when we discussed Beethoven's Consecration of the House Overture, is that orchestral fugues are really different from keyboard or fugues for limited numbers of instruments, because you always have more instruments than you have parts. And so when you do an orchestral fugue, the form of the fugue is going to be a little bit less strict. I mean, you want to give everybody something to do, and they can't all be playing like, you know, if you want to have like a four-part fugue and you've got horns and you've got oboes and you've got five-part string section, you want everybody to participate, and they can either double each other and like play the same music. And if you want to give them something else, you have to, it's not going to be as fugal. The bottom line is that you're going to hear more episode things than just plain strict counterpoint, you know, sort of dry, the dry melodies just chasing each other. It's not always dry, it depends on the tune. But this particular fugue you'll hear has episodes which sound suddenly very energetic and exciting and not terribly counterpoint-like at all. They all just come together and they play something until the very end. And when it gets really the apotheosis of the original subject. And the whole orchestra in unison plays the fugue subject. Now, there are no repeats in this movement, as I think I may have mentioned. If not, I'm mentioning it now, because fugues begin at the beginning and they end at the end. Begin at the beginning and they end at the end. So there's no need to repeat major sections. They just keep developing onward and onward for about 2.5 minutes. And what a vibrant, vital, fun movement this is, and how natural it sounds because of everything that we've heard before, because of Haydn's way of preparing us for the contrapuntal extravaganza, which is this finale. And here it is. Get it? It's really marvelous. It's just delightful music. And you know, one of the things that's so cool about it is that fugues and contrapuntal forms generally are always considered to be so learned and academic almost, you know, and so sort of inexpressive. And Haydn, it's never that way with Haydn. He has such a good time doing this, and he makes sure that we do as well, that listening is just such a joy. And that's what makes this symphony another one that no one ever plays, that nobody cares about, that's stuck in the middle of the Sturm und Drang period, but really comes from quite a bit earlier. That's what makes it so marvelous. And I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have talking about it, because, gosh, it's just great music. It's so original and so stimulating. It makes you feel good when it's over. It's like a nice cold shower after a hot day. It really is. So keep on listening, folks. Thanks so much for joining me. Number 41 is next. Take care.